Hi, I'm Davey. I'm awesome. And welcome to Davey's Awesome Wrestling, where I review wrestling-related things, all from the perspective of a fan, not an insider. And this last week was WWE's annual pay-per-view, Survivor Series. Like last year, Survivor Series War Games 2023. From Chicago, Illinois. Let's get into it. The opening match was the Women's War Games match, with Bianca Belair, Shotzi, Charlotte Flair, and Becky Lynch, versus four of the five members of Damage Control. Dakota Kai is still injured. And it was started by Bayley and Becky Lynch, followed by Shotzi, as their team got the advantage, followed by WWE Women's Champion Io Sky, followed by Bianca Belair, followed by Kairi Sane, followed by Charlotte Flair, and finally Asuka, meaning the War Games match officially started. I mean, it's a War Games, so of course it's going to be awesome. And there's always a lot of awesome moments, but just to name a couple, there was the moment that Io Sky took a trash can lid, put it over herself, and dove off the top of the cage. Not to be outdone, though, Charlotte Flair climbed to the top of the cage and did a moonsault onto all the Damage Control members. And it ended when Becky Lynch got the manhandle slam onto Bayley from the second rope through a table and got the pin, winning War Games for her team. Like I said, it's War Games. It's always awesome. 5 out of 5. Then for the WWE Intercontinental Championship, The Miz versus the longest reigning Intercontinental Champion of all time, Gunther. I hate to say it because, you know, I like these two, but this match was just eh. I mean, even though The Miz has now turned babyface, we still got what we expect out of The Miz. He's not above taking cheap shots when he did two consecutive low blows, but it didn't work because they wrestled for a little bit until Gunther got him into the Boston Crab with the knee in the back thing he does and got him to tap out, making him the winner. But like I said, I really expected more out of this match. It felt like a filler match. I would honestly only give this match a 2 out of 5. Yeah! Third match, Santos Escobar versus Dragon Lee. Obviously, because Santos Escobar left the LWO, feeling unappreciated, he took it out on Rey Mysterio, also took it out on Carlito, and then Dragon Lee, even though he's not officially an LWO, is taking the place to get revenge for them. Again, it's kind of upsetting that this match was just eh, because these two are two very awesome wrestlers, but it felt rushed. It felt like they were told, go out there, be quick. It also felt like a match that didn't belong on a pay-per-view. Like, there wasn't enough build-up or drama to it to get me at all invested. It felt like this should have just been a match on SmackDown. Like I said, it was just a short match where it felt like they didn't get enough time to really perform. I feel like if these two were given enough time and enough build-up to perform, they easily could put on a 5-star match. But this just went a little bit of back and forth until Santos got his finisher and the pin, and another one I'm only giving 2 out of 5. Yeah. Then for the WWE Women's World Championship, Zoe Stark challenged champion Rhea Ripley. This picked it up a little bit. I mean, this was really good, but it also felt rushed. Like, you get the feeling that this would have been a great match if these two were given enough time. But they weren't, so it felt like they were just trying to get all their stuff in. But again, even though it was rushed, they were rushing the back and forth, it was still pretty good, still kept my attention, and eventually Rhea Ripley got the Riptide onto Zoe Stark, got the pin, which wasn't at all surprising, but good enough to get a 3 out of 5. Then the main event, the men's War Games match, where instead of 4-4, it was going to be 5-on-5. On one team, Drew McIntyre and Judgment Day versus Cody Rhodes, Jey Uso, Sami Zayn, Seth freaking Rollins, and as announced, the returning Randy Orton. Seth Rollins and Finn Balor started the match, followed by JD McDonagh, as Judgment Day had the man advantage, followed by Jey Uso, followed by Damian Priest, followed by Sami Zayn, followed by Drew McIntyre, followed by Cody Rhodes, followed by Dominic Mysterio, and then when it was Randy Orton's turn, of course, he didn't come out right away, because they were also making it seem like he wasn't going to be there, which made us know he was definitely going to be there. And he didn't actually come out until Seth Rollins was hurt, so Rhea Ripley ran out with Damian Priest's Money in the Bank contract, was about to cash it in, finally Randy Orton's music played. Which means finally Randy Orton came out. Randy Orton, after being gone for like a year and a half, is finally back in WWE. Not to mention this match had an element that a lot of matches are always missing, and it gave us some cowbell. And like I said, it's War Games, it's awesome. It went until Cody Rhodes got the win over Damian Priest, which obviously means that their feud with Judgment Day is not over. And this match, like I said, it's War Games. It's awesome. You basically have to have just the worst possible winner to have a bad War Games match. 5 out of 5. Yeah! And then to end the night, as everybody is celebrating inside of the War Games cages, we get the music and entrance of CM Punk, who is officially back in WWE after 9 years, which everybody in the arena was excited about. Found out later that the people up at the ring, not so much. So, Survivor Series War Games overall was just okay. I know I gave 2 fives to the War Games matches, but they're War Games. Again, the only way for them not to get a 5 would be to just have the worst winners ever. And that's just War Games in general. Even since back in the WCW days, I've always been a huge fan of the War Games matches. But what disappoints me about this pay-per-view is all the other matches were clearly just there to give everybody something to do in the middle. It's kind of like going to a steakhouse, especially one that constantly brags about how they're the best steakhouse in the world. And you go there, and yeah, your steak is good. Your steak is great and well-cooked, but the vegetables are bland and the potatoes are watery. If you're going to brag about being the best, then the side dishes are going to have to be as good as the main course. And that's what the event felt like. The match at the beginning and the match at the end, War Games, go out there, put on a great match, entertain the people, and then the rest of you in the middle go do something. And I'm sorry, but I want more than just a couple marquee matches. The Intercontinental and the little grudge match, they were very lackluster. But I can't fault the wrestlers in the matches. The wrestlers are very good. They just clearly weren't given any time or any real build-up. Even the women's match, probably the best singles match of the night, but it was just okay. It wasn't great, which is sad because I know the two women in that match can have a great match if they're not told just go out there and hurry up. And then, of course, what everybody wants to talk about at the end of the night, when CM Punk returned, everybody's been asking me since, are you excited about CM Punk's return? I really want to be excited about it, but I'm not. Don't get me wrong, I love CM Punk. I'm a huge CM Punk fan. I have been a CM Punk fan for a very long time. I can't say since his Ring of Honor days because I wasn't able to watch Ring of Honor back then. But basically since the moment he came into WWE in ECW, I have been a CM Punk fan. I'm happy that he's wrestling still. I want to see him wrestle. But one, I can't like him being in WWE because WWE just does not seem to know what to do with anybody who isn't Roman Reigns or Logan Paul. And like I've stated before, the only thing they know what to do with those two is keep shoving them down our throat and demanding that we like them. Even though we keep telling them we don't like Logan Paul and Roman Reigns, we're sick of it. And already it's looking like CM Punk is going to feud with Seth Rollins over the World Heavyweight Championship, which might elevate that title a little bit. And honestly, I would say that's the route I'd rather them go, rather than just have him go into another match with Roman Reigns where he goes in and puts up a great fight, almost wins, Bloodline comes in, costs him the match, Roman Reigns capitalizes, and Roman Reigns wins again, because that's every single frickin' Roman Reigns match that has been happening for the last 3 years. Then again, we won't get that match for at least another 4 or 5 months, because, you know, he only wrestles 2-3 times a year now. The other reason I'm not that excited is, has CM Punk learned? Because as much as I love CM Punk, and I was happy when he was in AEW, everybody can sit here and get mad at Tony Khan all they want, CM Punk screwed himself in AEW because he would not stop causing fights over stupid little things. The last one being Jack Perry went out there, made a little jab at him during the event, and he couldn't handle it, despite the fact that he does that to pretty much everybody, especially in AEW. He'd go out there and take jabs at Eddie Kingston, Adam Page, the Young Bucks, Kenny Omega, and that was fine, but the moment somebody did it to him, he had to go start a fight. I will say, though, the good thing about him being in WWE is if he pulls that crap where he attacks his boss is now Triple H, he'll fight him. That's not a knock on Tony Khan, by the way, because you look at Tony Khan, of course he's not going to fight him. But it's also confusing to me that after all this stuff that they would take him back, knowing he's probably just going to cause a fight and become a liability. We'll see, though. Who knows? Maybe this humbled him up a little bit to go, you know what, I need to just think about business and stop taking everything so personally. Maybe, maybe not. We'll see in the future. I hope it works out, because one way or another, I want CM Punk in wrestling. But as much as I would have liked to have been all giddy and excited that, yay, CM Punk is back, I'm actually just sitting there watching going, oh, CM Punk's back. Please don't screw this up. But to the event itself, as far as Survivor Series War Games goes, because of the two War Games matches that are always extremely entertaining, that's the only reason I would give this at least a 3 out of 5. Yay! So there you have it. This is my wrestling review this week. I hope you guys enjoyed it. And if you did, make sure to hit like, hit subscribe, hit the little bell so you get notifications for when I post new videos, and leave a comment. Tell me what you thought of Survivor Series War Games. Tell me if you're excited that CM Punk is back in WWE. Love you guys.